So over the past year, the Bitcoin network has reached its maximum capacity. All the blocks are becoming full. And as a result, there's been a lot of debate about how we can scale Bitcoin in the future. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of those proposals and what they could mean and what's the trade-offs. Some of the technical solutions have been proposed to improve the scalability of Bitcoin so that it can handle more and more users. Because if Bitcoin was to become mainstream, then it needs a lot more scalability than it has right now. And the problem is that when Bitcoin was first created, the founder of Bitcoin, who originally published the code, about a year after he published the code, he inserted a block size limit, or what's called a block size limit, in the code, which means that each block has a maximum block size of 1 megabyte. So to give a quick recap of how the Bitcoin network works, the Bitcoin network is a decentralized system where anyone can run their own node, and these nodes all have a copy of what's called the blockchain. And the blockchain is essentially a series of blocks that contain all of the transactions in the system. The creator of Bitcoin realized that there's a potential problem here of what's called a denial of service attack. Someone could potentially spam the network with transactions and make blocks that are very big. And so he created a limit that each block should be no bigger than 1 megabyte. And this limit is hard-coded in all of the software that you use to run a Bitcoin client or node on your own computer. So that means your software will automatically reject any block that is bigger than 1 megabyte. And now we've reached a point where blocks are becoming full. They've reached a maximum capacity of 1 megabyte. And so no new transactions can be put in the blocks. So that gives us a capacity of around 3 to 7 transactions per second, which isn't very much, because there's now more demand for more transactions per second in the network as the network has grown.
Is it a simple case of if we were able to make these blocks bigger, you could fit more transactions in?
Sure, yes, you can do that. If you make the blocks bigger, it's a naive and very simple way of increasing scalability. But the main argument against it from its critics has been that if you increase the block size, then the blockchain itself will get bigger. And that means every single person who runs a Bitcoin node on their computers, what's called a full node, has to have all of the data of the whole blockchain in order to verify the whole blockchain correctly. If we increase the block size, you will need more and more storage to store a copy of the blockchain. And this is a problem because the whole point of Bitcoin is that it's a decentralized system. Anyone should be able to run their own node. When this limit was first added in 2009, 2010, the Bitcoin wasn't as popular, so it was much easier to modify the code and insert new changes and controversial or protocol rules like that. Now it's a much bigger space, so now each little change needs a lot more consensus, if you like. Because if you wanted to increase the block size, this would create what's called a hard fork. You would essentially create a blockchain that's incompatible with all of the existing nodes that run on the Bitcoin network. Because the existing nodes, they will reject any block that is bigger than 1 megabyte, and everyone will have to upgrade all of their software. So this is a kind of change that requires every single person to agree to it, or the majority of the ecosystem to agree to it. People who are thinking about how to scale Bitcoin kind of really fit into two camps. The people who are advocates of what's called on-chain scaling and people who are advocates of what's called off-chain scaling. The idea of on-chain scaling is that we want to increase the capacity of the Bitcoin network by increasing the number of transactions that we actually put on the blockchain itself. And you would do that by increasing the block size. And yes, that would make it more expensive to run a Bitcoin full node. But the argument is that the majority of Bitcoin users don't run Bitcoin nodes anyway. If you have a Bitcoin wallet on your phone, or if you use a web wallet, it's not a proper Bitcoin node. Your wallet trusts a different node or some centralized service to some extent to get information about the Bitcoin network and get information out of the blockchain. So one of the original creator of Bitcoin said is that he expects that as the blockchain grows in size, ordinary people will no longer be able to run nodes, and nodes will become super nodes. You will have to have access to a data center to run nodes. And that was kind of part of the plan. And but one of the things that the creator of Bitcoin anticipated was that Moore's law would catch up with the blockchain size, so that regardless, it wouldn't be that expensive for someone to store a copy of the blockchain. But unfortunately, Moore's law has been somewhat dead for the past few years. Hard drive storage has largely remained at roughly the same cost for the past few years. It's kind of stopped, and that's kind of created a problem. So that's what on-chain scaling is about. The idea of off-chain scaling is that let's move the transactions out of the blockchain. Do we really need to port every small little transaction, like if you go to a coffee shop and buy coffee, do we really need to put that on the blockchain? And do we really want every single person who runs a Bitcoin node to have a copy of that little transaction? So the idea of off-chain scaling is let's only put big or important transactions on the blockchain, and let's put all of those microtransactions off the blockchain. And one of the proposals for doing that is a system called the Lightning Network. And the Lightning Network is basically uses something called payment channels between different individuals to facilitate off-chain payments. For example, Alice might send Bob $10 and then Bob sends Alice $5 the next day. So what they do is, instead of having every single payment on the blockchain, they just keep a balance sheet between them, and they put all of the payments on that balance sheet. And then, for example, after a month, they say, let's see what is the final balance and let's settle that balance on the blockchain. So you only need to put that final payment on the blockchain rather than every single payment in between. And you can extend this. Alice has a payment channel with Bob, and Bob has a payment channel with Charlie. And let's suppose Alice wants to pay Charlie. Alice can route that payment through Bob, which would then send that payment to Charlie. And this is the idea of the Lightning Network. We use a route or a network of payment channels, and you would find the route between person to person that you can make that payment off the blockchain. And in theory, this sounds like a really great idea, but there are some controversies around it. So some people don't think that it would be very feasible if this would be used by millions of users for every single person to find a route between any other person in a decentralized way. Because one of the things with the Lightning Network is that in order to establish a payment channel, you have to deposit a certain amount of money, which is at least a minimum amount of money of how much you expect to go through that payment channel. And that some people just don't have the upfront capital. So people expect what's called large payment hubs to facilitate that. So you would have a large payment hub that has a large amount of deposit inside of it, and you would route your payments through that. So in some way, there's a bit of centralization involved with that. If you have on-chain scaling, we have supernodes. But if you have off-chain scaling, we might have large centralized payment hubs. So it's still a bit of centralization involved in both. Bitcoin Cash. When Bitcoin Cash forked off from Bitcoin, the value of Bitcoin Cash on the first day was something like $500. So people got $500 per coin for free out of thin air when this fork happened. So it's possible that some people, that the value of Bitcoin has risen.